Good morning, friends. It's a joy to be together as the people of God this morning. An announcement today, if you've mainly been tuning in to our pre-recorded service, we're going to be changing up next week how we're doing some of these things. And I do want to say right off the bat, if there's any concern about these changes, please talk to me because I want to make sure that people aren't left out. So what we're looking at doing is if you have been watching the live stream, so I guess you wouldn't even be seeing this, then nothing is going to change. But if you've been watching a pre-recorded service, we're going to take a recording of our live in-person service and post that online to be watched, and that will be able to be watched through YouTube or on Facebook. And so an email with those additional links will be going out. I'll probably get that uploaded right around noon. So I know that's a little later than now, but as it is right now, it's 8:15 and I'm recording the service and then trying to get that uploaded before our 9:30 and then before our 11 o'clock. So it would be just a little more manageable and sustainable in the long run to do this. So that's why we're making that change. We have made some changes so the audio quality should be much better for our live service. But as always, again, if there's any concerns that you have, please reach out to me because I want to make sure that people aren't left behind on this. You know, my commitment to all of you is still that wherever you are with feelings of comfort, whether it's still worshiping from home or coming to our service with masks and distancing and no singing, or coming to our service without masks and where we sing, I want to make sure that your spiritual needs are and your spiritual desire for worship is being attended to in the best way we can in this difficult time. So starting next week, you won't see me here in my living room anymore. You'll be seeing me in the pulpit, but I still look forward to connecting with you. And like I said, thank you for your understanding in this. And if you have any questions, comments, or concerns, please don't hesitate to let me know. Let's now pray together. God of grace, you have given us minds to know you, hearts to love you, and voices to sing your praise. Fill us with your Spirit that we may celebrate your glory and worship you in spirit and in truth through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our call to worship this morning is taken from Psalm 118, verse 24. And we're going to repeat it three times, and the refrain is, "We will rejoice and be glad in it." This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. Friends, we do seek to rejoice in the presence of God, and yet we also know that at times we feel guilt, we feel shame, because we've fallen short of being the people we want to be. Therefore, I invite you now to join with me in our unison prayer of confession. Let's pray together. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. By what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Let us now take a moment to silently confess our sins to God. having now confessed our sins to God and also dedicated our hearts to living obediently to Him, hear this good news. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning is taken from the book of Genesis, chapter 11, verses 1 through 9. This is the account of the Tower of Babel. Now the whole world had one language and a common speech. As people moved eastward, they found a plain in Shinar and settled there. They said to each other, "Come, let us make bricks and bake them thoroughly." They used brick instead of stone and tar for mortar. Then they said, "Come, let us build for ourselves a city with a tower that reaches to the heavens, so that we may make a name for ourselves. Otherwise, we will be scattered over the face of the whole earth." But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower the people were building. The Lord said, "If as one people speaking the same language they have begun to do this, then nothing they plan to do will be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and confuse their language, so they will not understand each other." So the Lord scattered from them. The Lord scattered them from there over all the earth, and they stopped building the city. That is why it was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of the whole world. From there the Lord scattered them over the face of the whole earth. May the Lord add His blessing to the reading of His word. Let's once again turn to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, on this day we come to You as Your people. We thank You that as we have gathered together, Your presence is with us. As we have confessed our sins, You have heard our confessions and offered forgiveness. Lord, we recognize that You are a good and faithful God who is loving and kind, and who is patient and full of mercy and grace. We thank You that our lives are marked by Your goodness shining through into our day-to-day interactions with You and others. And Lord, as we see Your goodness in our midst, we pray that we would see You more. We pray that we would see Your hand at work in a mighty way in our lives and in the lives of those around us. Lord, we know that there are those who need Your healing touch. Whether battling this disease that has so plagued our nation, or battling the regular challenges of life that seem to be an extra headache on top of everything else that's going on, Lord, we ask that Your healing touch would be with them, that Your care and mercy would extend to them. Lord, for those who are suffering in this time from loneliness, from brokenness of heart, from feeling down and having to deal with despair, Lord, we pray that You would come alongside them and build them up and support them. And Lord, as people are struggling in this time, struggling to put food on their table, struggling, Lord, to make ends meet, we ask that You would be with them as their provider and sustainer. Lord, we know that this is a difficult season in the life of the church as well. And as we've been gathering together virtually, our hearts long to be together in person. And yet, Lord, we know that this is not yet the time when we can all safely be together. So we ask that by the power of Your Spirit, You would draw us near to one another as Your people, one church, one body, committed to You, our one Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We now pray together the prayer that You taught Your disciples to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Today we finish up our series on beginnings, and one of the themes of all of these beginnings in Genesis is that the scope felt so large. It starts in the beginning of Genesis with creation of the heavens and the earth, and it's just, it's big. It's big, and the stories are big, and even as God is creating Adam and Eve, and it's a story about a few people, they're put in a big garden, and it has huge implications with the fall. And then we hear the story of Noah and the implications there of all the world and how that the world was wicked and that God was tired of their detestable practices and the violence that so marked humanity. And then Noah is delivered and they see it as this catastrophe, of course, because it's just completely changing the world. And now, as we get to the end, we're getting to the Tower of Babel, and the story is once again big. All people together in one place, building one city, building one tower, and it's going to change everything. And then the next turn that we get, if you've been reading along, is now all of a sudden starting a family story. The family of Abraham. And so it goes from being big and shrinks it down to the very personal level and the implications for the God of the universe being the God of Abraham. And that story, of course, leads to where we are today. But, well, that's another story in our Bible to study for another day. But here in Genesis 11, I think that there is something important that happens. It shows one of the important themes of the Bible, that we as people fall into patterns. If you look, many of the ideas of the Bible are cyclical. They happen over and over and over again, specifically with how humanity responds to life. And so when we start in this account with the Tower of Babel, the whole world had one language and a common speech, and people are moving eastward and they build a town. And they start with the most modern of technology, right? Come, let us make bricks and bake them thoroughly. They used brick instead of stone and tar for mortar. So if you're having a brick-based rather than just piling stones on each other, you can build more efficiently with the resources they have and build better structures. And that's exactly what they plan to do. They're building a city and they say, come, let us build for us a city with a tower that reaches to the heavens so that we may make a name for ourselves. The theme of disobedience to God is one that occurs over and over and over again in the Bible. And here, it did not take long for humanity to want to fall back into that fundamental disobedience that we see back in the garden, which is to elevate themselves onto the same level with God. How are they doing this? By literally just building up to the heavens. If we built up to the place where God dwells, I imagine this is the thinking in their mind, then if we build up to where God is, then we'll be equal with God. God's not going to be up there and we're down here. We'll have a way to level the playing field, if you will. So, what happens? Well, God sees that in their human ambition and in their coordination, they have the opportunity to achieve great things. God doesn't laugh off what they're doing. When humanity sets their mind on one thing and they work together, great things are possible. There are hints of that in our world today. But, of course, we have problems that quite oftentimes get in the way of that. And, you know, just as an aside, I couldn't help but speculate in this. That what if that creative energy that humanity had been used not to try to make themselves on an even level with God, but to to do things to serve God or to fulfill their purpose that they had to care for the world, to be fruitful and multiply, to spread out. And the language there is echoed if you go back to Genesis chapter 9 with the covenant with Noah, be fruitful and increase in number and fill the earth. You know, they weren't filling the earth. They were making a big city that they feared being spread out. And they say, you know, we can show that we can stand on our own. What if that creative energy had been used instead to obey and glorify God? I think that's something that we'll see one day, see in the new kingdom where we live under God, that as humanity, our creative energy and maybe something that bears from us the image of God is used in the right way. But anyway, they're not using it the right way. They're building a tower because they don't want to be scattered out. So they say, come, let us build for ourselves a city with a tower that reaches to the heavens so that we may make a name for ourselves. Otherwise, we will be scattered over the face of the whole earth. If we can make a name for ourselves, if we can put ourselves on an even level with God, then we won't have anything to worry about. Echoes of the garden right there. If we eat from this tree of knowledge of good and evil, we'll be like God. That was the deception there of the tempter, wasn't it? And so how does it go? Well, it does not go well, as you might imagine. The Lord came down to see the city and the tower the people were building. And I do think that I find it a little funny that, you know, they're supposed to be building to the heavens, and what does God have to do to see the city and the tower? God comes down. Apparently they were in building process, of course, but had not made it so far. And the Lord said, if as one people speaking the same language they've begun to do this, then nothing they plan to do will be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and confuse their language so they will not understand each other. So one of the things that we see is time and time again in Scripture, not only does humanity decide to go their own way, but they, in running afoul of the boundaries that God has given them, because what was the command? To be fruitful and multiply, be fruitful and increase in number and fill the earth. Not to make one big city with a tower to heaven to rival God. When humanity runs afoul of what God would command them to do, there are consequences. And these are things that we cannot escape in the Bible. But I think it shows here, as we've seen from earlier chapters, that God's heart is not one to look to punish. God wants us to live in obedience with his commands for us. And when we don't, there are consequences. And you'll note that compared to the last time that humanity is doing their own thing, this is a much more measured response by God, isn't it? It's not a flood that's going to destroy the whole earth. It's a going down and confusing their language so that they're not going to understand each other. And it continues then in verse 8. So the Lord scattered them from there all over the earth, and they stopped building the city. That's why it's called Babel, because the Lord confused the language of the whole world. And from there, the Lord scattered them over the face of the whole earth. So we see, first of all, that humanity, we're not going to give up our drive to be like God. That's going to become a recurring theme, or take things into our own hands, you know, to say, we want it, I want it my way. I was just listening to Frank sing that when I was in the shower earlier. Anyway, and then second, we see that God is going to bring consequences when we transgress the boundaries that God has set out for us. This is just part of the reality, especially of the Old Testament, until we see things change in the New Testament in a marked way. But make no mistake, there's always a consequence to sin, even if it's not God bringing punishment, because God gives us boundaries to protect ourselves and to protect others. Sometimes we see God as the agent of the consequences, and sometimes we realize that, take for example, murder. You know, that someone else pays the price of someone doing that violent act. All right? That's not God's punishment on anyone. That is the effects of our human sin spiraling out and having consequences on one another. I mean, take any of the commandments that deal with our neighbors and how we're supposed to treat them. That's why Jesus gives us the whole commandment to love our neighbors as ourselves, because if we're loving them, then we're not going to steal from them, kill them, covet what they have an affair with their wife and destroy their family, all these things. Loving them gives us a different way, but we, even with those simplified boundaries of love God and love neighbor, we still struggle. So finally, you get to the last point, that there are the consequences and God spreads people out. And this is something that the text does not explicitly say, but I want to point to. Here, we see that God's redemptive plan is, I think, starting to be revealed, because we're not just students of the book of Genesis, we're students of the whole of Scripture. And so in Genesis 11, what happens? That their languages are confused, and there, from there, they're scattered over the face of the whole earth. And we know that different languages and different nations have led to many atrocities in our time. We've seen terrible things that happen in the world when people can look at others with a different language, with a different nationality, and say, oh, you know, it's them. They're the people who are at fault. The people of God, the Jews, some of the most horrible recipients of that type of hate that is based on the difference that we see from this account. So did God just do this and set us all up for failure? Well, again, a difference between what goes on in the human heart, and this is where we need to look ahead in the Bible. In Isaiah chapter 2, you get this picture of people coming together from different nations, but I want to call to your mind the example of Pentecost. And in Acts chapter 2, what do we see? We see that God sends the Holy Spirit, and people are hearing the word of God in their own native tongues. The Spirit is redeeming what humanity has taken and made so broken in separating people. The languages. It doesn't have to be something bad. Obviously, it was done with a purpose, but it doesn't have to be the bad that leads to hate and genocide and so many atrocities. But in Acts, we see God redeeming that, and not by just pressing the undo button, but by having a more beautiful and more creative solution. I think we also see this redemptive work when we go back to what is the first consequence of sin. It's to be kicked out of the garden and ultimately face death. And of course, we know the redemptive arc that has to do with death, because it involves the death and resurrection of Jesus, who invites us to die with him, that we also may live with him. So we start to see the redemptive arc of God here. And I don't want us to miss that, because that's one of the most important parts of the story of God, that it doesn't just end with judgment, it ends with redemption. So as we prepare at some point to venture more into the story of Genesis with Abram and the story of his family there, and go from this very cosmic to a very personal story, I want us to think about the pattern that we've seen here that will serve as a good guide wherever we are reading our scriptures, that as humanity, we're prone to think that we know best, to do it our way and not God's way. We're also prone to find the boundaries of God and transgress them, even when there might be consequences that are brought, whether from God or brought because our sinful desires hurt other people. And finally, and I think probably most importantly for us, is that God's not done yet. The story is not over. Even as we hear of these terrible things, even as we face difficult and terrible things today, that God's redemptive story is not done yet. And so I hope that these three things can stick in our mind, whether we're studying Genesis or Hebrews or wherever in our Bible, we see the pattern that is revealed through Scripture and where the different elements of those things pop up in whatever we're reading. And let us remember, as we conclude, that endnote, that God's redemptive work is what this points to. There's the need for it, that's seen because we're doing our own thing, because we're transgressing those boundaries, but that's what it points to, that we have a God who doesn't respond just with vengeance and anger to cast people out, to punish them, but who wants to make things new, who wants to take the brokenness of the world and heal it. And praise God, because that's exactly what God does. Let's now affirm our faith together in the ancient words of the Apostles' Creed. Sisters and brothers, what is it that we believe? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into Hades. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Friends, we have heard the call of a God who is generous, who is loving and caring, who redeems our brokenness, who binds up the brokenhearted, who gives new life to those whose life has ended. In light of God's generosity, let us too live with generosity and giving in our hearts. And having acknowledged that that's how we've decided to live our lives, let us sing together now the doxology. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Friends, may we now go from here knowing that we have a God who is our Redeemer. A God who, no matter what we do, will love us with a perfect love. No matter what we do, nothing can make God love us more. Nothing can make God love us less. Let us look expectantly to this loving heart of God to be revealed in our stories, in our biblical story, and throughout all of history. Receive now the blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen.